give to you, and you give to me. True love, so and on it'll always be. True love, for you and I have a guardian angel on high, with nothing to do but to give to you and to give to me. Love forever true, for you and I have a guardian angel on high, with nothing to do but to give to you and to give to me. Love forever true. Love forever true.
Now there's a bit of nostalgia for those of us who are old enough to remember the 1956 film High Society, a musical romantic comedy starring Bing Crosby and Grace Kelly. The song reflects themes of nostalgia, longing, and the enduring nature of true love, and became one of the most famous songs from the film. True love is difficult, if not impossible, to define, but somewhere inside us all we seek it. Perhaps the truest of loves is that which God bestows on us, and that being the case, we want to love him in response. Much has been written about loving God in Christian literature, and we do need to be sure what we really mean when we say we love God. Unfortunately, it is the way of humanity to tie love closely to feelings alone, and perhaps that is more emotions rather than love. Now, I am not suggesting that our love for God is devoid of emotions. That would be denying our humanity. However, I suspect that real love for God and Jesus has some very practical characteristics to it, and today I just want to look at two which I believe are fundamental in loving God. Unto thee, O Saviour King, our allegiance now we bring, body, soul, and spirit all, in obedience to thy call. Thank you. Jesus emphasized the importance of following his teachings as a demonstration of love. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you." This means adhering to the moral and ethical principles Jesus taught, such as love, forgiveness, compassion, and service to others. Generally speaking, we have seen the promise of Jesus for another helper as a reference to the overall work of the Holy Spirit. But is Jesus being more specific here? The disciples had the presence of Jesus to help them keep his commandments. However, he soon would leave them, and keeping his commandments would be more challenging. Perhaps Jesus was promising them the Holy Spirit in a more specific way, not just to be his ongoing presence in their lives, but also a guide and counselor who would assist them in keeping his commandments.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. And all I have within me, I give you praise. And all
Now, the Bible is full of commandments, and if we are to hesitate and check if we are being obedient to them, chances are we will get little achieved. Fortunately, Jesus, in his discussion with the Pharisees in Matthew 22, reduced it to two simple commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. The reality is that if we implicitly obey these two commandments, we will keep all the commandments. It is important to understand that an authentic love is more than just a feeling. It is a commitment that transcends all emotions. The act involves deliberately putting someone else's well-being before your own. Here in John 14, Jesus calls us to choose his way of living, the kingdom lifestyle, a commitment that must be expressed through intentional action. Embracing obedient love is a journey. It is not just a destination, it is a way of life. The commandments are not about perfection. They are about growth and learning on a continuous basis. We all stumble and make mistakes, but Jesus offers constant forgiveness and guidance. I believe the key to obeying Jesus is to keep in mind his teachings and principles, not to blindly follow rules. Therefore, it is a continual process of growth and reflection that takes place over time, as opposed to something that can be achieved once and for all in a single one-time act. We need to develop the habit of asking ourselves two questions. What does obedience to God look like in this situation? And what can I do to obey God more fully? The proof of our love for God is in our obedience to his word. Obedience derives from one of three primary motivations. We obey because we have to, because we need to, or because we want to. A slave obeys his master because he has to. An employee obeys his employer because he needs to. He wants to get his paycheck. However, as Christians, we obey our Heavenly Father out of love because we choose to do so.
Thank you.
The other way we demonstrate our love for God is by living constantly in a mindset of gratitude. I'm not talking about the reaction we may have in those occasional encounters when we realize the goodness of God. Rather, I am thinking of a mindset that is continually focused on each and everything we receive in life and consciously perceives it as coming from our Creator God. In both the feeding of the 5,000 and the Last Supper, Jesus demonstrates his love for God by giving thanks. Gratitude is a recurring theme throughout the Bible, and it's seen as an essential part of faith, acknowledging God's role in all aspects of life and expressing trust in his ongoing care and provision. The Christian needs to be aware and live in a state of gratefulness and thankfulness to God for everything he has provided for us. I suspect that it is the nature of humanity to take many things for granted and give little thought to developing an attitude of gratitude. Sometimes I wonder if being ungrateful is part of our fallen humanity. Perhaps more than anyone else, James has a clearer concept when he writes. So don't be misled, my dear brothers and sisters. Whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. It is the way of human nature to seek out the novel and the spectacular rather than to be contented with what God has provided for us. The reality of human nature is that we are quickly discontented, a fact which advertisers use to convince us that we will be far more contented if we buy that which they are promoting. An attitude of gratitude should be the hallmark of Christians, reflected in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Paul has a firm conviction that praise issuing from gratitude is basic to the Christian's relationship with God, and such a positive mindset is psychologically sound. The truth is that when we come to know the authentic reality of forgiveness and new life in Christ, we experience the great wells of gratitude and praise. No doubt, as Paul took up his pen to write to the Christians at Rome, he reflected from a heart full of gratitude to God as one who had been born at the wrong time. His life had been dramatically changed on the Damascus Road. He was totally overwhelmed with God's grace in his life, and as a result, his life overflows with gratitude and praise.
I'm speaking to you out of deep gratitude for all that God has given me, and especially as I have responsibilities in relation to you. Living then, as every one of you does, in pure grace, it's important that you not misinterpret yourselves as people who are bringing this goodness to God. No, God brings it all to you. The only accurate way to understand ourselves is by what God is and by what He has done for us, not by what we are and what we do for Him.
In order to understand thankfulness better, we need to take a closer look at this subject. It is important to express gratitude for the good as well as the bad, as well as the positive and the negative. Occasionally we feel that God has not answered our prayers in our perceived best interest, and we find it difficult to be grateful for that which didn't work out as we had expected. It is important to maintain an open and honest relationship with God, yet to accept His will for our lives, as Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. We can only come to a place of real and authentic gratitude, which is the prerequisite for a meaningful relationship with God, when we are convinced that God is working all things together for our good. Our love for God is demonstrated by following the teachings of Jesus, which is a commitment that transcends all emotions. Much of this is a practical and obedient way of living in the kingdom lifestyle, directed and sustained by the Word of God. The proof of our love for God is in our obedience to His Word, and out of our experience in this kingdom lifestyle springs an authentic attitude of gratitude and thankfulness. Thank you, Lord, for all your goodness through the years of yesterday. Thank you too for present mercies and your blessings on my way. Thank you for each revelation and for what you choose to hide. Thank you, Lord, for grace sustaining as I in your love abide.